The principles of treatment, this was taken from the third edition of the depression guidelines from the American Psychiatric Association. So you want to establish and maintain a therapeutic alliance. And this is important because you want to build that trust and relationship with a patient and get them on board because treatment is dependent on their ability to trust you and to be adherent to therapy. Additionally, you want to complete the psychiatric assessment and evaluate the safety of the patient. Is the patient safe with the people around them? Are they safe towards themselves? And then you also want to establish appropriate setting for treatment. Not every patient can just get a prescription for an antidepressant and get sent home. Sometimes they need to go under observation. Sometimes they need to be in a facility that allows for 24/7 monitoring. And then you also want to evaluate the functionality and the quality of their life. Coordinate patient care with other clinicians. Depression is a disease state that often presents as a comorbid condition or as a result of a bunch of other comorbid chronic conditions, such as diabetes, hypertension. And so a lot of times these patients will be on drug therapy for those conditions, and you want to make sure that whatever you're putting them on is going to be harmonious. And you want to monitor the patient's psychiatric status and then also enhance treatment adherence. And it's also really important to provide education to the patient as well as to the family, because the family provides a strong support network for the patient so they can help overcome this depression. The diagnostic criteria for depression is based off of the DSM-5, and the symptoms, you must have 5 or more of the following symptoms for at least 2 weeks and they have to represent a change from previous functioning. And these symptoms can be depressed mood for most of the day, markedly diminished interest or pleasure in all or almost all activities for most of the day. Patients can experience significant weight loss or weight gain, and they can have increased or decreased appetites. Patients can also experience either insomnia or hypersomnia, and they can also have psychomotor agitation or retardation. Fatigue or loss of energy is a common symptom that presents, and the feeling of worthlessness or excessive inappropriate guilt is another diagnosis criteria. Patients can also have diminished ability to concentrate or be indecisive, and they can also have recurrent thoughts of death, suicidal ideation, and without a specific plan for committing suicide. And these symptoms must cause clinically significant distress or impairment in social, occupational, or other important areas of their functioning. Symptoms are not, and it's important to rule out other causes of what the symptoms are, so symptoms can't be due to substance abuse or other medical condition. And when we treat the patients, treatment is usually broken up into 3 different phases. The first phase is the acute phase, and for the acute phase, the treatment goal is to induce remission of the depressive episode and to achieve a full return to the patient's baseline level of function. Treatment options for the acute phase include pharmacotherapy. And antidepressants are typically recommended as initial therapy for mild to moderate major depressive episodes or disorders. Patients can also have depression-focused psychotherapy. They can also be trialed in electroconvulsive therapy. And electroconvulsive therapy is a treatment of choice for patients with severe depressive disorder that's not responsive to the psychotherapeutic or pharmacological options. And it's particularly used or beneficial in patients who have significant functional impairment that needs like a quick fix. Because with antidepressants, it takes about 4 to 6 weeks to work. So some patients are at such a high risk that they need something that's going to act a lot faster. It's also recommended for patients who have psychotic or catatonic features, and for pregnant patients as well, it's an option. Then there's also transcranial magnetic stimulation as well as light therapy that can be used for patients in the acute phase. And when treating these patients, you want to make sure that you're assessing the therapies throughout the course of treatment, and it's okay to use a combination of the features of the treatment options here. And you just want to evaluate the conditions continually. continually and just check in on their other comorbid conditions as well, see how those are doing. So when we talk about assessing treatment response, if there has been no symptomatic improvement after 1 month, treatment should be modified. And 48 weeks of treatment is needed before concluding that a patient is partially responsive or unresponsive to a specific intervention. You want to assess treatment response every 48 weeks, and the acute phase lasts for a minimum of 6 to 12 weeks. And then for the continuation phase, the goal here is to eliminate residual symptoms or prevent relapse. The dose in the acute phase should be continued in the maintenance phase, and you want to continue for about 4 to 9 months. And if patient responded to the ECT therapy, they can continue on it, or they can be initiated on pharmacotherapy. So it's essentially a step down because they have more time to, we have the time to give them the 4 to 6 weeks to respond. Monitor patients for signs of possible relapse, that's really important. And then also consider depression-focused psychotherapy as an adjunctive therapy if the patient is not already on it. The best evidence is for CBT. And for the maintenance phase, the goal here is to prevent recurrence. And to reduce the risk of recurrent depressive episodes, some patients should proceed with the maintenance phase. What this means is not every patient will need a maintenance phase. And so I've highlighted some characteristics here that puts patients at a higher risk, and therefore they should be on the maintenance phase. So if a patient has 3 or more prior major depressive episodes, then they are at risk, increased risk. Presence of residual symptoms, ongoing psychosocial stressors, early age onset, and family history of mood disorders. And for many patients, particularly those with chronic and recurrent major depressive disorders, some form of maintenance therapy will be needed indefinitely. Here's a treatment algorithm for uncomplicated depression that I just put here just to help guide practice. Now we go into the medications, which is something I'll provide more details about. But medications that we can use to treat these patients are tricyclic antidepressants, monoamine oxidase inhibitors, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, mixed serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, norepinephrine, dopamine reuptake inhibitors, mixed serotonergic effects, and drugs that are serotonin alpha 2 adrenergic antagonists. First up is the tricyclic antidepressants. I provided some examples, and they include amitriptyline, dasipramine, doxepin, imipramine, and nortriptyline. The mechanism of action is they inhibit the reuptake mechanisms of norepinephrine and serotonin. Some of the adverse effects that patients can experience while being on a tricyclic antidepressant is the anticholinergic effects, and this can be examples such as dry mouth, constipation, blurred vision, urinary retention, dizziness, tachycardia. Some patients can have memory impairment, and at high doses, patients can exhibit signs of delirium. The anticholinergic effects of tricyclic antidepressants can be limiting in patients who are elderly, and so that's why we don't commonly see patients who are elderly on this. Orthostatic hypotension is another side effect that patients can have, and this is typically dose dependent. Patients can also experience weight gain and sexual dysfunction. And it's important to note that with tricyclic antidepressants, overdose can result in arrhythmias. And so you want to exercise with caution when prescribing them in patients with clinically significant cardiac disease. Here is just a dosing table to provide you with some guidance on what doses the patients are typically started with and what the dosing range are. Again, these are just recommended ranges and guidelines. Some patients may require higher doses for initial or they might be dosed outside of the range. For monoamine oxidase inhibitors, these are phenylephrine, phenylephrine, and tranexamfetamine. Mechanisms of action for this is that they inhibit the actions of monoamine oxidase, which is an enzyme that breaks down norepinephrine, serotonin, and dopamine. Some of the adverse side effects that patients can experience are postural hypotension, and that's more likely to occur with phenylephrine than with tranexamfetamine, and it can be minimized by dividing the doses up. Patients can also experience weight gain, sexual side effects such as decreased libido or orgasmia. Patients on phenylephrine can have sedation effects, while patients on tranexamfetamine can have stimulating effects, and the stimulating effects can keep them up at night, so just be aware of that if you are going to write for the medication to try to use them in the daytime. And then patients can also experience fever, myotonic jerking, brisk deep tendon reflexes can occur, and also hypertensive crisis. And hypertensive crisis can occur when an MAOI is taken with certain foods that are high in tyramine, and it can result in cerebrovascular accident and death. Symptoms of this include occipital headaches, stiff neck, patients can have nausea, vomiting, sweating, and a sharply elevated blood pressure. Patients who are taking the selegiline patch for depression, and if the patch is about 6 milligrams in a day, then they don't have to modify their diet. But if you're going to prescribe a patch that's 9 or 12 milligrams in a day, then you should counsel them on modification of diet. And you just want to tell them to avoid foods that are high in tyramine. Examples of this includes aged cheese, sour cream, yogurt, wine, or canned meat. Again, here are some dosing recommendations. For selective serotonin inhibitors, we have citalopram, escitalopram, fluoxetine, fluvoxamine, paroxetine, and sertraline. And these work by allosterically inhibiting the SERT transporter. They cause mineral inhibition of the norepinephrine transporter or blocking actions of adrenergic and cholinergic receptors. Some of the adverse effects that patients can experience include GI, symptoms such as nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Patients can also experience sexual dysfunction, headache, insomnia, or QT prolongation with citalopram. And now the dosing recommendation for citalopram is not to exceed 40 milligrams because of the QT prolongation. Fluvoxamine is not approved for the treatment of